विश्वं दर्पण दृश्यमान नगरी तुल्यन्निजान्तर्गतं पश्यन्नात्मनि मायया बहिर्बोद्भूतं यथा निद्रया यस्साक्षात् कुरुते प्रबोधसमये स्वात्मानमेवाद्वयं तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये बीजस्यान्तरिवाङ्कुरो जगदिदं प्राङ्निर्विकल्पं पुनः मायाकल्पितदेशकालकलना वैचित्र्यचित्रीकृतं मायावीव विजृम्भयत्यपि महायोगी वयस्वेच्छया तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततन्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः अथ द्वितीयोऽध्यायः श्रीभगवानुवाच यं हि न व्यथयन्त्येते पुरुषं पुरुषर्षभ समदुःखसुखं धीरम् सोमृतत्वाय कल्पते सो In two lines, the first line is a description of a jnani. Second line is a description of a person who wants to be jnani. That's the difference between the two. So the first line has, we have seen in the yesterday, yam hi na vyathayantyete purusham purusharshabha. So, he purusharshabha. A Purusharshabha means, O prominent among the human beings, it's an address to the Arjuna. We have seen yesterday why Bhagavan is telling him Purusharshabha. So the person whom this Sukha and Dukkha or the Matras Parshaha do not affect, the contact of his sense organs, when it comes in the touch, contact with the world, sensory world, well, they do not affect. They do not affect means something is generated. Through contact something is generated, but he is not affected. Because it is at other level. Shita, Ushna, Amana, Apmana, everything is at other level. And therefore, he is not affected at all because of the knowledge. What is that level, Swamiji? That is at the level of the body. When he knows himself very clearly, when he is abided in Jnanam, that I am different, distinct from three bodies. Well, then definitely this is not going to affect him. So it's a description of a jnani, definitely. So with same, and then the next line says, samadukha sukham dhiram saha amrutatvaya kalpate. this person, saha, this person or he is kalpate, he is fit, amrutatvaya, he is fit for moksha. Definitely then this line talks about a person who is not jnani yet. He wants to be jnani or he wants to have a moksha. He wants to gain moksha, but then definitely what he has to do? Samadukha sukham. He should have a sameness towards pleasure and pain. Well, it's really very funny thing, I tell you. There cannot be a sameness. Sukham will be sukham. Dukham will be dukham. What is the sameness in this? But anyway, I will discuss that. When Bhagavan says, definitely it has some purpose. Anyway, from some standpoint, you can make the thing same. That's our own Vyavahara shows. From certain standpoint, where generally we find a difference, if we take a different standpoint, they all club into one group. They become same. Well, I will talk about it a little later. First, we will discuss this. How can you make the pleasure and pain same? I mean, it should not affect your mind because this person is having an eye sense in the body. And definitely then this dukkha and sukha are going to be generated and he will have the opinion also, I am dukkhi, I am sukhi. Because for him, the self and the body is one thing alone. It's a self-confusion. We are discussing this thing. And therefore, he has that eye sense in the body. And whenever heat, cold, etc., pleasure, pain, insult, respect, everything when it comes, he will equate with himself. Even though it is at the body level, but he will equate with himself. And therefore, then his mind would not be in the same condition, definitely. So, then there are certain, means by which you can make them same. In Shastra, I'm going by Shastra, modern way, they are all saying that, you see a pleasure in a pain and you see pain in a pleasure and all that. That's something very, very funny. But anyway, but Shastra has certain means. And the first means for making them equal is apratyaya. In Sanskrit, they call it as apratyaya. Pratyaya means attention. Apratyaya means don't pay attention. To what? To sukha and dukkha. Well, I'm ready, Swamiji, not to pay attention to sukham. Okay, but dukkham, pain, even though I don't want, I am going to pay attention. What we are trying to say is, when you pay attention to the pain, you really feel the pain. And I will tell you your own experience. Like, I told in satsang also, when a woman is married and she has children and everything, and nowadays, what happens is, everybody is at home because of this pandemic situation. And then the whole family in the home and the whole responsibility she is carrying. Right now, the most unfavorable thing is for women. Somebody complained me also. Swamiji, I was, I don't know this, why this corona has come. Because I'm tired now because all are at home. And they one by one, please bring tea, please make some nashta, all the time. Such a woman, suppose, because of her tiredness, and she is having certain weakness also, and when she went to bed, she was having a fever and body ache also. Definitely negative, we should consider that negative test for corona, definitely. But she is having, because of tiredness, whole day she is working. And also this, husbands also say, keep everything clean, because they say in a dirty place, they accumulate and everything. So she has to do this also. Anyway, so she's tired. Now in morning, even she took tablet, the fever reduced, but again the temperature rose. And when she got up in the morning, she was having a fever, body ache, everything. But there is no way out, because they are at home. They will, even though if she wants to sleep, they will not allow her to sleep. So she gets up and starts making tea and making nashta and everything. I tell you, during that 1 hour or whatever it may be, she may be having a temperature of 103. I tell you, during that 1 hour, she will not feel the temperature. because she's engaged in activity, but and not paying attention to the fever, etc. Well, she won't feel. After 1 hour, when everything is over, she feels that really now she's tired, and she the temperature also must have, you know, gone up because of a lot of work she did. So when you don't pay attention to the pain, well, you won't feel the pain. Second example I will give. You are sitting somewhere like in some class, and you have taken a vow that in presence of like Pooja Swamiji, etc. is there, I would not like to sit on a chair. I will sit with the folded legs. When you sit with the folded legs, definitely, you know, sometimes that blood circulation stops. But during 1 hour, you are so engrossed in Pooja Swamiji's talk that you don't feel that your leg has gone. When it is over and when you want to get up, you are not able to get up. Not that blood has stopped at the last moment when the lecture is going to be over. No. It has stopped since long. And I mean, whatever that kind of, you know, the particular kind of a feeling we have, and that feeling also is there. But you have not paid attention. Your attention was somewhere else. Well, you really don't feel the pain. This is called apratyaya, not paying attention to dukkha. What about Sukham Swamiji? Please don't pay. If you want to be fit for for moksha, never pay attention to this pleasurable situation. Because why? I tell you. See, in Yoga Shastra, they have told the pancha klesha. Avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha. Avidya, ignorance. Well, there is self-confusion, born of self-ignorance. Therefore, this body I take as a myself. And when I take the body as a myself, then I am going to feel the limitation, lack within, discomfort within. To remove the discomfort, I have a desire. I have certain objects of happiness. I desire those objects to remove the discomfort, to remove the sense of limitation. And that object of desire, you want that object of desire, object of happiness, let's say. So that is called raga. Raga means what, you know? Raga and dvesha are nothing but the desires only. A desire for something you want to have, or you have got it, but you have a desire to retain, that's called raga. Two things are there in this raga. You have a craving for something to get, and once you get it, you have a desire to retain also. Then you should know that you have a raga for this particular object. Dvesha is also a desire to avoid, or a desire to get rid of. You have already, but you want to get rid of, or you don't have it, but there is a possibility that it is coming. Then you want to avoid some. Then it is called dvesha, a dislike for that object. So basically, raga dveshas are desire born of basically a lack within. And raga and dvesha are basically pertaining, that you have likes and dislikes pertaining to the self, which is self-confusion. Because the body is considered as a self. What is conducive to the body, I have a liking. What is non-conducive to the body, I don't like it. Like, let's just talk about this heat and cold. When you say, I like in this situation, I like a certain warmth. Why? Because you are feeling cold. Then Atma is feeling cold or body is feeling cold? Body is feeling cold. But you don't have that sense that body is feeling cold. I am feeling cold. Therefore, that shows these raga dveshas are for the self, which is confused self, not the self which is Sachidananda. And so definitely, when you fulfill those raga dveshas, you are indirectly nourishing the confusion. You make it more, and your confusion, you are making it more and more firm, more and more firm your notion about yourself that I am the body, that notion you are making it stronger by fulfilling raga dvesha. Because they are all pertaining to the self, which is body. A body means I am talking about physical body, but you should consider even the subtle body also, everything. I mean senses, mind, everything. So basically, even the situation of a sukha etc. comes, don't pay attention. They are not in, I mean you will definitely, you are progressing somewhat in by shravanam etc. in this line, and you are in a path of getting moksha. If you fulfill those raga dveshas, definitely you are making the notion stronger. Which notion? I am the body. And therefore, it is not in your advantage. Please. So, avidya generates asmita. Asmita means asmi. Asmi iti bhavaha asmita. Asmi means I am. But I am body. Not I am just. I am body. Born of avidya is also klesha. Asmita means I am the body. Then definitely once you say I am the body, well, you are feeling limitation. You want to get rid of it because it's unnatural to you. Your nature is limitless fullness, by the way. And so definitely this, once you have that sense that I am the body, the raga dveshas are going to be generated. So that is raga and dvesha are also klesha. And you fulfill raga dvesha, abhinivesha takes place. Abhinivesha means a stronger, more rooted, what? The notion, confusion, I am the body. More you fulfill raga dveshas, more you will make firm that I am the body. Because they are at the level of body only. The desire at the level of body only. Body means, please take it here, all subtle body, gross body, everything. I just say body. So, which is really a non-self, but for you it is the self. Confusion is there. And therefore, definitely, abhinivesha means a stronger notion, stronger and stronger. You are. So, one way you are doing a shravanam to get rid of this notion, and other way you are fulfilling this raga dvesha and making the notion stronger. And that is how the progress does not take place. That's how they say, if a person wants to get rid of this notion that I am the body, etc., I am Sachidananda, etc., then he should have a titiksha. Endurance. Whatever situation comes, a situation of a pain or a pleasure. A second thing also I would like to tell, that is told in Apastamba Dharma Sutra, which is really a beautiful thing. What it says is, that when person gets, you know, something happens, he was craving for and that thing happened. And then in that situation, he gets a harsha. Harsha means, you know, that intense pleasure. What's another English word for that? Can I tell that intense pleasure? Harsha. Jalpaji, I think harsha means a very intense pleasure. You know, you get ecstasy of joy. I mean. So, harsha shokam. So harsha means this kind of intense pleasure. You have a craving that something should happen, and it happened. Something you wanted and that thing you got it, suppose. Then you get that intense pleasure. And when you get an intense pleasure, you lose yourself. And you might have seen it also, like Archimedes, you know, Eureka, Eureka, Eureka. That was a state when he almost was mad. He lost himself. What Apastamba Dharma Sutra says is, when that kind of a ecstasy takes place in your mind, then if one negative tendency arises, which is called darpaha, that which Bhagavan has talked about, dambho darpo bhi manasya, in the 14th chapter Bhagavan has talked about, a pride arises in you. And this is a specific kind of a pride, in which you feel that you are better than everybody else. You are very fortunate. Such thing happens when any favorable things happens, which he was craving for, or otherwise also it can happen. Like you have certain knowledge, which you generally don't find other people have. Like you may have a certain skills which you don't find generally people have. Well, you are born in a certain family where you get inherited property. And well, other people are definitely deprived of because you have got such a wealth even without your earning. Then you always feel that you are special. You are above all these people. Then people generally call it as a superiority complex. It's something, that kind of a thing. Superior. You are superior to other people. And people sometimes they give they talk also. They express this thing. I am much, much better than other people. I am more fortunate. Like that they talk also. That is called darpaha. So when any kind of favorable situation happens, which he was craving intensely, then he get that harsha, intense pleasure, and out of intense pleasure, darpa, pride also arises. That I am so fortunate. See, I was craving for and I got it. The other person is craving, but he has not got it. And when darpa arises, definitely one tendency develops is to cross the limit of dharma. And so you may hurt other person saying that, look at me. Look at me and look at yourself. You do something. Say how fortunate I am. And thereby they hurt the person. Or he does some action by which he hurts others. And he invites trouble. Swamiji, how will you say invite troubles? Well, that's what the law of karma says. Not today, tomorrow. So actually the situation is this favorable situation. I mean, there something happened which he was craving for. Well, it has ultimately led himself to this situation. And therefore, basically, either sukha or dukkha, any situation arise in our life, don't pay too much attention to that. By that, your mind will be in equipoise. That is, samadukha sukham is explained, to make such a state, sameness of, mind in pleasure and pain, etc. This is the first upaya. I will tell you something about, see how these Indian women are so wise. You know, in olden days, right now I don't know whether they may be there in southern India, but whoever the child, whenever the child is born, after a certain time, they do a piercing in the, they pierce ear, put some earring for boy or for girl, everyone. So they do that. Now definitely the child is going to cry. So when the child cries, you know what they do is, they put a piece of jaggery in his mouth. And now definitely the child likes that jaggery. But if he cries and keeps mouth open, he cannot taste the jaggery. And when he wants to taste the jaggery, he has to close the mouth. Then he cannot cry. And therefore, to make the child free from this crying, they put a piece of jaggery. So when his attention goes to the jaggery, taste of the jaggery, he forgets this pain. Could you follow what I'm saying? He forgets the pain. So, and if his attention goes to the pain and then starts crying, then he cannot taste it. And therefore, when his attention goes to the taste of jaggery, definitely his mouth gets closed also, and his attention is towards the jaggery, then he forgets the pain. That's what they are doing. So always when you pay attention to your pain, well, you really feel the pain. You really feel the pain. I have seen the one painter. He was cutting some fruits, and he got an injury in the right hand with a knife. Then it was quite a deep cut. And well, of course, for two, 3 days he could not paint, but then he could not remain. And he started. And in 3 days, as though it has, the blood has, stopped coming out, oozing out. And then he started that. And he was painting and he was so engrossed that he must have hurt himself again at this place, and then blood has really come out. But his attention was there and he did not realize it. After a certain part is over, his attention has gone, then he found that all the drops of blood is falling down. And then his attention has come here, now he is feeling the pain again. What I am saying is, when you are doing something which you like, even though your physical condition may be perhaps not so conducive, you are feeling a pain in your body, etc., your attention goes to another place where you are not feeling the pain. This is what is happening. So this is that's how the beautiful thing is, not apratyaya, they call. Pratyaya means attention. Apratyaya means not paying attention either to pain or to the pleasure. So both ways, if you look this way, then you can definitely, you will ignore that. Second thing, there is another way also. Suppose somebody says, Swamiji, this is just a talk. It's all lip service. This I can't do. Okay, no problem. That person says, Swamiji, if it is so, let me come to your room. And I will come with that, you know, that needle. And let me prick in your hand. And then you don't pay attention to it. I would like to see that. So instead of inviting such a situation, I would jump into the second means. Okay. The second thing is called asvikaraha. Asvikaraha means non-acceptance. You don't accept pain as a pain. First thing is, pain is there, but you are not paying attention. The second means is, pain you don't accept as a pain. I will give you an example also. And children, when they play around, when they are small, and mother is cooking something, and she is sitting in folded legs. In those days, all the mothers used to sit down and cook. So she is with folded legs, sitting on the floor, and she was cooking, and the child was playing around, and then suddenly it comes and jumps into the lap of the mother. And literally the mother has, almost fallen like thing. She just fell like that. And definitely it has created a little pain, physical pain. But I tell you, in mother's heart, there is no pain. Even though there is a physical pain, she has not accepted the pain created by his own child as a pain. So this is called non-acceptance of a pain as a pain. And that is how, and any example, Bhagavan is an example for that. You know what happened is, most of you must be knowing the story, and that Bhrigu went to Lord Vishnu. He wanted to test who is really, a jnani, who does not react, etc., etc. So he went to Brahmaji. Then he got a sense of disgust because Brahmaji reacted. He did something and then Brahmaji reacted. So he said no. Then he came to Vishnu, and Bhagavan was lying in that bed, his own that bed of serpent bed, and this Bhrigu came and kicked with his leg on the chest of Vishnu. Bhagavan was sleeping, and so when he got a kick, he suddenly got up, and he found the Bhrigu is there. And then what he said is, he just got up. Even though he got a kick, he got up and he did a prostration to Bhrigu. And what he said is very important. He said, "O Maharshi, I hope your feet has not been injured." Why are you saying? Because people tell that my heart is very, 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 it is like a stone. I don't get pleased easily. Even people do penance for years and years and years. Brahmaji gets pleased so easily. Shiva gets pleased so easily. He is called Ashutosha. Ashu means Shigram, quickly. Toshaha means getting pleased. So Shiva is called Ashutosha. He gets pleased so easily. But people, the seekers who are doing a lot of penance and they want a certain boon or they want me, whatever they are, but I don't get pleased so easily. My heart does not melt so easily. It is like a stone. To such a heart, I mean to my chest, you have kicked. So I have not got any injury, but because of a stone-like heart, your legs might have got some injury. Look, the pain is not looked upon as a pain. And something more also he said. He said, the Mahatmas, you know, their hearts are basically like a butter. Even the butter, it gets slightest heat, they just melt away. So the Mahatma's heart also is like a butter. Whenever they see and people in pain, so due to that heat of the people, pain of the people, they just melt away. And not only Mahatma's heart is like butter, their feet also is like that, very very soft. And you are a Mahatma, your feet is very very soft, and they got heat by stone like heart. And so I am really concerned that whether your legs are really injured or not. And he took the fit and doing some kind of a massage kind of a thing. So nahi amma mayani tirthani nadeva mrchilamayaha te punarupande punanti urukalena sadde evatu darshanadeva sadavaha. He also said something more, that even the tirtha devatas etc. also are very very, their hearts also are like that. They give results of action after a long time because their heart don't get melt. But these Mahatmas, basically, you know, they are so straightforward, and they are so soft in their heart. They give immediate the fruits of action. And by listening that, Bhrigu became so happy, because even though he has hit and started, thought of that Vishnu is going to react, but Bhagavan did not take that pain as a pain. That I wanted to convey. Well, this is Bhagavan, Swamiji, what are you talking about? You come down to our level. This is Bhagavan wanted to teach some lesson to us. We should not wait for somebody's kick, but I am saying that in some simple situations also, the pain is not accepted as a pain. Bhagapuja Swamiji tells something else which I don't want to discuss. That I will discuss when the Karma Yoga will come. I will discuss how Puja Swamiji looks at the situation of a pain. Well, that's a part of Karma Yoga. So we will not touch it right now. Then the third thing is Vichara. Two means are over. First is Apratyaya. Second is Asvikaraha. And the third is a certain kind of a thinking. And this thinking also is of three types. Either way you can think and you can make the pleasure and pain equal. First, just with respect to actions. There are three ways of thinking. Keeping action in the center, keeping devotion in the center, keeping knowledge in the center. Just keeping action in the center, if you have a certain thinking pattern, then you can make this pleasure and pain equal. So what is that? Avashyameva bhoktavyam kritam karma shubhashubham na bhuktam kshiyate karma kalpakoti shatairapi. So I mean, whatever may be the result of an action, that is pleasure or pain, pleasure or pain is a result of an actions only. And this result of action, whether I experience while crying or while I experience while laughing, I have to experience those pleasure or pain. And therefore, avashyameva bhoktavyam krutam karma shubhashubham, shubha ashubha, pleasure or pain, avashyameva bhoktavyam, you have to experience, you have to undergo that experience of pleasure and pain. Kritam karma, kritam means I have done it, and the result is in terms of shubham or ashubham, pleasure or pain, I will have to I will have to experience them. Nabuktam kshiyate karma kalpakoti shatairapi. Abuktam karma na kshiyate. Which you have not experienced yet, that kind of a result of election, you will have to experience even kalpakoti, even in thousands of years, it is lying as it is. And once you experience it only, then and they will go. Without that, they will not die. And therefore, whatever it comes, pleasure or pain, I will have to undergo experience. So let me experience them with a smiling face. It's ultimately my own karma only. And there is another one which is very beautiful. What I told also, that karika also is very, very, very popular. And other one also is there. Avashyam bhavi bhavanam pratikaro bhavedyadi tada dukkhaina lipyeran nala rama yudhishthiraha. So it says avashyam bhavi bhavanam. I mean, the person may be intelligent, person may be very strong, person may be has done so many good karmas in his life, whatever it may be, but then avashyam bhavi bhavanam, the results of pleasure and pain which are going to come in your life, pratikaro bhavedyadi, if you can stop them coming to your life, especially the painful situations, then these people would not have pain at all, would not have undergone pain. Who? Nalaraja. Oh my God. Nala was to listen the story of a life of Nala. Nalaraja. I mean, devatas also, they say, devatas also wait to listen the story of Nalaraja. He was an emperor. Nala was an emperor and was having so much in his life. But the situation happened so that, in the forest, they had to go, and Damayanti also was lost in the process, his wife, etc. Tremendous pain, tremendous. Anyway, so he was such an emperor and was such a strong person, but could not prevent a painful situation. Then Rama, you know very well, I don't want to say about Lord Rama and Yudhishthira also. Well, he was a Dharmatma. And Yudhishthira was a Dharmatma all throughout the life. And very, very, very powerful person. We always think about Arjuna. When the Pandavas were talked about, our attention goes to Arjuna. But Yudhishthira was also Yudhishthira. Yudhi, in the Yuddha, in the war, Sthiraha, one remains steadfast. Means he was so strong person. And therefore, such a person also could not prevent a painful situation. Yudhishthira has suffered a lot. If you want to know, please refer Mahabharatam. And you will definitely cry the way he has suffered. I mean, and the one, we know one, two, three things only, that they had gone to forest for 14 years and all that. Apart from it, when the Duryodhana has given a poison, from then onwards, so many things happened in their life. So many things. So, keeping karma in the center, you can make your pain or definitely even pleasure also equal. So, welcoming the pleasure and no admission to the pain, well, you remove both the boards now. Keeping the board, welcome, and keeping the board, no admission, remove the board. Let it come, whatever it comes. Because we are not going to face the situations which these people, the great people of the Yugas, Nalaram Yudhishthira has been purposely told. Nala was an example of a Krita Yuga. Rama was an example of a Treta Yuga, and Yudhishthira is an example of a Dvapara. Then what, in Hindi they say, hum then kis khet ki muli. This is how. So then what about us? We are nothing. We are nothing against them. Such a great people. I consider everyone great who had a Lord Krishna's direct darshanam. I tell you, it's an event which I feel it's a so rare thing to see Krishna, in a human form. You can imagine what it would be. When you see his narration, I would like to, I mean, just I'm digressing from the topic, but I would like to tell you one thing. His power, that is Maya, out of that the whole creation is made. When you look into the creation, certain things, you know, certain birds, flowers, a certain nature, your mouth gets open, thinking that what a beautiful thing. When you see a certain animal, certain fish, aquatic animals, you feel what a creation. It is just it's a amsha. It's a small amsha of the Maya, Ishvara's power. Then one who has willed is the Maya and taken a form. What a form it would be. No, that's how the gopi kya hum bhi, we also get attracted to that if we see him. And so these are so fortunate people, Yudhishthira and all, they are so fortunate that Krishna was moved with them in this form. It's an amazing thing. And we will not have that such a thing, you know, in our own life or in the other lives also. Anyway, what I'm saying is, but still they could not avoid the pain and the amount of pain they have suffered. Well, such a situation of pain is never going to come. Never going to come in anybody's life. Anyway, chalo. That's a way of looking at it. One angle, which are analysis or a thinking pattern based on, centered on action. Second is based on devotion also, you can make pleasure and pain equal. How? Whatever is happening in your life, well, that's a part of Karma Yoga only, but we'll discuss a little bit. So whatever happens in your life is a prasada or given by Ishvara as a Karma Faladata. So whatever is, I mean, pleasure or pain, anything in your life which is coming, it is nothing but it is given by Ishvara, and that is always in my benefit. That's how it is called grace. Grace is nothing but a karma phala. Grace is not something intangible thing which is coming out of from his hand or something. Grace is the situation which you have got. It's a karma phala. But you look upon it that it has come down from the Ishvara, and therefore you accept it gracefully. That's how it is called grace. A situation which you look upon gracefully, relating to the Ishvara as a karma phala data, well, then the same situation is called grace of Ishvara. And therefore, both things are given by Ishvara, who is nothing but a Vaidya for me. Vaidya Narayano Harihi. And therefore, a pain has come, well, that's a medicine he is giving me, bitter medicine. And pleasure means some sweets also is giving me, but both are required for me, and therefore this is also looked upon like this. And that is how in Ramanujacharya ji has, they have in Vishishtadvaitam, that the concept of Sharanagati is very well narrated. And Ramanujacharya ji talks about six kinds of surrender to the Ishvara, in which one of that is Anukulyasya Sankalpaha Pratikulyasya Varjanam. Anukulyasya Sankalpaha. Anukulyasya Sankalpa means what is conducive to the Ishvara is conducive to me. What Ishvara likes, I like. What is not conducive to Ishvara, that is also not conducive to me. Therefore, Ishvara, whenever is giving me any situation, well, in his mind, he thinks this is the best for him, and then I should accept it. Anukulyasya sankalpaha pratikulyasya varjanam. What is anukulam to Ishvara is anukulam for me. What is pratikula to Ishvara is pratikula to me. Well, that's called surrender. That's one of the sharanagati or surrender talked about by Ramanujacharya ji. He talked about shodha sharanagati. Shodha means sixfold sharanagati. Anyway, so this is a devotion. Surrender, attitude of surrender. So whatever situation has come in my life is given by Ishvara, and it is always in my benefit. So, well, I accept it. So this is how you can make the pleasure and pain equal in your mind. Then the third thing is, the third way of thinking is jnana, knowledge. Of course, this is just for the sake of this discussion I'm doing. But yesterday I told you about a certain intellectual conviction. Well, this falls into that category also. After a certain study, at least your intellect should be convinced about this. What? that this whole world is made of Maya. Maya is Upadana. Anything made of Maya is basically Mayavi, that is Mithya. Like, what is, you know, we call this magician a Mayavi. When he is called, magician is called a Mayavi, then that magician, whatever he creates, we call it, that is his Maya. And that creation, you are able to see, 500 people are there, all are able to see that, his creation, but it is not real, right? So his creation is called Maya, Maya creation, Maya, Maya, means it's just a nothing but his power of magic, which is called Maya, manifest in this way. I told you about an example of in Hyderabad, which I have really experienced is, I went to one magician's show in some theater in Hyderabad, and all the doors are closed, and he started all doing all kinds of things, and suddenly one elephant has passed through from the row of this seats. There was a single, it was a lane like thing going towards the stage, and then one beautiful elephant, he just walked like this. We all got screamed. We started screaming at him. And then we thought, and no door is open, and how can he came in? And he showed, he came up to the stage, he did not go up to this, but then he came near the stage. Everyone saw, within 2 minutes, without opening any single door, it vanished also. It vanished. The same way, this Parameshwara also is a great magician. And he has also a magical power called Maya. Out of that, he creates this creation. You cannot say there is no creation. Yeah, you cannot say there is no elephant. Yeah, because you experience. But it is not real. So, what is created out of Maya is Mithya. This is an intellectual conviction. Don't think Swamiji is telling too much, you know. But I'm telling you, have an intellectual conviction that the creation, the cause of the creation is Maya. The material cause of the creation is Maya. Let's say that way. Material cause of creation is Maya. Whole creation is just Maya only. Manifestation of the Maya only. Material cause only manifests as a karyam effect. So this is the thing. And also you can, well, there, such a creation is there. Then from this creation, any situation which arises in for me, for which I should not laugh also, I should not cry also. Because it's not real. Like that. You should think. Like then you should tell, you know, this is auto-suggestion. Like in a drama, if somebody dies, will you really cry or not? So people cry. Of course, that's a different thing. But knowing Mithya, they cry. That's a amazing thing. That's an amazing thing. Knowing Mithya, they enter into the theater, they cry, laugh, everything, and they come out also. And they tell other also to go. Every mature person, elder person knows that what he is going to see. Child may not be knowing. But the elderly person knows that what he is going to see, a death of an actor or something, that's false. That fellow is sitting in Mumbai and enjoying. I mean, he has not died. But still, you pay, sometimes people do even, all this, but what I'm saying is they stand up in a queue and take the ticket and go inside and, experience everything and they cry, laugh, everything and they come out. Of course, inside they must be feeling very relaxed that I am not only having a pain, other people are also there to have a pain. So, you know, this is a very human psychology. I told you the example, I think, in this class only. When suppose in your home, when the lights are off, the power is not there. It has just gone. Immediately what a person does, you know, he does not check his own system. He will ask the neighbor, do you have power? He or she says, no, we also don't have power. You feel somewhat relaxation. So that is how Puranas are helping. All the stories of Nala, Rama, Yudhishthira or the people talk, we should not see the other's pain. It should not be our attitude. Let me see somebody's pain, then I will feel relaxed. I mean, that's not my criteria. But you feel some relaxation. Definitely you feel. That's a human psychology. It will be like this. Anyway, so you go into the movie with a heavy heart and to get some entertainment. And that entertainment is in form of crying. People cry and cry. So tissue papers are, you know, bunch of tissue papers they keep. And they cry and cry. You can fill up the buckets of tears. And they feel relaxed. That's called entertainment. Entertainment is crying. You should cry so much that you feel relaxed ultimately. You could not cry at home, definitely. Especially male cannot cry. That's what in India, this is the thing. A male, you are a male, how can you cry? So where will he cry then? He also undergoes so much of pain, so he goes to the movie and cries. Anyway, what I am saying is, an intellectual conviction is a goal of a Vedantin before jumping into the abundance in the knowledge. Intellectual conviction. That's how Shravanam Mananam is first thing. Nididhyasanam later. It will come. But Shravanam Mananam, let me be clear about the nature of creation, nature of the situation which I face daily. So that also can give this kind of a equal, I mean, you become, for towards pleasure and pain, you will have a this kind of a sameness. So this is a vichara. And the fourth one is, as such, people generally, you know, apply this, the fourth method for making the mind from pleasure and pain, free from pleasure and pain, experience of pleasure and pain. That is a witnessing a situation. And that has been told by one particular group also, which is very popular in here in the world. They try to make you a witness of everything. So, being just a witness, you see everything. The idea here is, whatever you experience, well, we are going to discuss also tomorrow in the morning class, whatever you experience is of a one category, which is called drishyam. Drishyam. From the standpoint of drishyam, sukham and dukkham becomes equal. Please understand this. Sukham and dukkham are not equal. Sukham is sukham. Dukkham is dukkham. You are able to identify. Therefore, please, that kind of an thinking that sukha and dukkha, he doesn't find any difference between sukha and dukkha. That is not the meaning of samasukha dukkham. He is seeing sukham as a sukham, dukkham as a dukkham. He is seeing pleasure as a pleasure, pain as a pain. But with respect to, with a particular point of view, these two things become equal. I will give you an example. Like there is a census in India. A sense population, I mean the counting. When you count in terms of a human being, right? Then you say there are, let's say, 120 million people. Let's say 120 million people in India. Now, from that standpoint, you have made one group. But if I ask you how many males and how many females, well, you again divide. You look different. The same thing now you look it little differently. If I tell you with respect to religion, please tell me how many Hindus are there, how many Muslims are there. Well, from that standpoint, you again divide. Right? But just from the standpoint of a simple census or a population, I mean, population, you merge them into one. They become equal. All human beings equal, including women, man, and whatever the religion, everything you, all the differences you resolve, you make them one. Please understand this example. So a certain standpoint is there by which a generally, which is called a pleasure, which is called a pain, and they are different, definitely different, they become equal. They become same. And what is that standpoint? Whatever you experience, a pain or a pleasure, it is basically drishyam. Any object of experience is drishyam. and I am drashta. Drashta can never be drishyam. Drishyam can never be drashta. And therefore, I am the drashta of all the situations which either may be pleasurable, either may be painful. And with this aspect, you are making both the situations equal. They are just drishyam. And many people are employing this method also, and they are able to control to an extent in negative tendencies of their mind, especially anger, lust, greed. Then they, if the greed arises, rather than nourishing the greed at certain desire of object, intense desire, rather than fulfilling through the action, they wash it. They become drashta of their own mind with that particular negative tendency. And in a course of time, it just settles down. The intensity would not be the same if you make a distance of drashta and drishyam. A greed is an object of experience. Lust is an object of experience. Everything is an object of experience. That's how you are able to tell that I have a greed now, or I am greedy, I am angry now. Means anger has arisen in your mind. That's how people sometimes warn also to others. If you talk more, I am going to lose my temper. Better you go away. Or better I will go away, whatever. So you know, it's a matter of your experience, object of your experience. Well, if it is an object of experience, you are subject of the experience, called experiencer. Experiencer and experience are two different things. They can never become one. Never. It's a poles apart. One is subject, one is object. Subject is subject, object is object. We are going to discuss tomorrow, because now we'll have to discuss Sachinananda, Atma, etc. We'll have to go through this process of knower, known, etc. category, or experiencer, experience category. Anyway, so this is the fourth way of making it. And ultimately, so this samasukha dukham will be, you can, by this means, you can make it, you can make them same. Then says dhiram, then another word, dhiram. Dhiram means, I have to explain this dhiram word, I will go to Upanishad mantra which talks about it. Kashchit dhiraha pratyagatmanam aikshata avrutta chakshuhu amrutattvam icchande. Like, pleasure and pain are made equal even by farmers. Farmers would not bother when they are working in the field, and they work in all the seasons. It may be heat, it may be cold, and not only just heat and cold, they are deprived of many, many pleasures. Many, many pleasures. They undergo pain also, varieties of the pains they invite also. So it looks that farmers also have titiksha. Farmers also are equal in terms of pleasure and pain. And especially the Indian farmer, I don't know, here also it may be the same thing. But Indian farmers are really working hard. Really working hard. In all the seasons, if it is a summer, it may be a winter, even the heavy rain. In India, the rain is not like here. I feel here there is nothing. There are cats and dogs. I heard that cats and dogs are, the rain is like, what is that? Pouring cats and dogs? What it says? Anyway, whatever it may be. You are shy not to say. You can tell. Anyway, so that kind of a rain, torrential rain. It's a tropical country and the rains are very, very high. A very heavy rain. Any season, Shita Ushna equal, heat cold equal, pleasure pain equal, everything equal. Then do Bhagavan talk about farmers? Cannot be. Why? Why? Amrutatvaya kalpate. Kalpate. Such a person who is, in pleasure and pain and heat and cold, and if he is equal, one who is having this endurance, titiksha, is fit for moksha. Then all the farmers are fit for moksha. They are eligible for moksha. But we don't find a single farmer listening to the scriptures. Then something else is required. What is required? Well, we talk tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Anybody has a question? Anybody has a question? I have still 5 minutes. You can ask.
Swamiji, every day it's going to be at 4:15.
Yes, yes. Because 5:30 we have a temple time.
Okay.
So, Aarti, etc. So, I am supposed to reach by 5:30. Even though it is 4-5 minutes only from here. Not much. But I keep a 15 minutes gap. This time is conducive, right, to all of you,
Yes.
Okay. Hari Om then. I am going to end the meeting.
Hari Om.
4:15, chappai.